Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Trinity. Today we are going to begin with the opening hymn, He Lives. And if you want to follow along in the hymnal, it's page 310, or the words will be on the screen.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, wherever foes may say. I see a land of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives. Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. I ask thee how I know He lives. He lives within. Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the hope of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Today, but I'm glad you all are here and glad you're here joining us over technology. If you're just tuning in for the first time, my name is David Abbott and I'm the senior pastor here at Trinity. Don't worry, I'm not near as important as that sounds. How's everybody? Good? Ooh, I heard from John Hartman. I heard he was good. Yeah? Mary, I heard your voice just now. You good? All right, we're good. So glad you were able to be with us this week. Excited for what the Lord has in store for us. Exciting day today, excited to be together again. Hopefully when you came in, you're able to grab one of our yellow announcement sheets. On the front is our announcements, on the back is a place to take notes during the sermon. I have been known to say something worth remembering. Not often, but sometimes we have it there for you just in case. But wanted to draw your attention to a few of them. If you look on the very front, wherever you're sitting, if you look right in front of you in the back of the pew there, you'll see our QR code. That's something we just, Lanessa and Clela worked on over the last month. You can take your phone, scan that QR code. It's going to take you right to our website, going to take you to an event calendar, take you to some FAQs if you're new or wanting to find out a little more about Trinity. So feel free to do that. We are continuing to update and use our website, use our Facebook page. Often I post something on there or post it on my personal page and then share it with the church's page. So continue to check that out on a weekly basis. I know as things are back, school's back in session, we're in the fall, we're going to start ramping up again. We've been pretty slow in terms of like a lot of events, which has been nice to kind of catch our breath. But you want to always check that out to keep abreast of what's going on. If you look at the next one down below, often after service we have Fireside Cafe, which is, for lack of a better term, our Sunday school class, where we get together and we just see how everybody's doing who's in the class, and then we spend a chunk of time going over the sermon we just heard, maybe in a little bit of a greater detail. So it's often very enjoyable, but today, as you see, we're not going to have it because today is a special day. If you've been with us any length of time over the last month or so, we have sent off Kalila and Will to Guatemala. They'll be there for the rest of 2024, coming back to us around the Christmas holidays. And so we lose close friends. Kalila, we lose a staff member, and then we lost a good chunk of our worship team between Will and Kalila. And yet, it didn't take us very long to find, I think, adequate, suitable replacements. Many of you guys got to meet David and Jordan Winker when they were here on my sabbatical giving the message. I told many of you that they were our first, second, and third picks to help us through the remainder of the year. And so David and Jordan's first Sunday is today, so we want to make sure to welcome them. I'm excited that they're with us. You're going to hear beautiful music, beautiful voices. And then after the service, the reason we have no Fireside Cafe is we're hoping that you all can join us, stay for just a little bit, and we're going to have a little celebration welcoming David and Jordan. For those who were here 2 weeks ago, we had a send-off for Will and Clela, and I liked the cake so much I asked Alicia to get another one. So we got good cake again and refreshments. So hope that you can stay after service for a little bit, say hi to David and Jordan, fellowship together with them and one another. That'll be immediately after the service. While we're dismissing after the service today, if you are here and interested in our Guatemala trip, we're looking to set up a mission trip for anybody interested heading down to Guatemala in 2025, our spring break coming up here like in March. That info meeting is right after service. So I'll kind of give the benediction like I do, and as I'm greeting people and getting ready in the back there, if you're interested in Guatemala, maybe just come down to the couple front rows, meet with Lanessa. If you come, you don't have to sign up or anything like that, but if you're just interested in saying, hey, is this an option or a possibility for me next year, stay for that meeting, and that should be on there as well. And then I have one more announcement before we go into our Be the Church time. This one's not on your sheet, but I hope you mark your calendar. September 1st is in 2 weeks, and we have a very special Sunday that has been called by our district superintendent, Russ Abel, through the conference, the Indiana Conference, and Bishop Trimble, but they wanted to give every pastor and staff member a Sunday off, right? And they know there's, you guys have been gracious, and I got my sabbatical just recent, but there's many churches that their staff just never gets a break. And so September 1st is going to be like church, pastor, and staff respite day. So what's that mean? What that means is we won't have church in person. However, Russ is our district superintendent, is going to be delivering the message. And then five of us churches, including your very Trinity right here, pastors have gotten together to do like the prayers, the word of the Lord, call to worship, and those type of things. So we're going to have a full service, but it's going to be online. So September 1st. Sleep in. Seriously? Like, none of y'all want to sleep in? This is ridiculous. Like, I'm so excited for this. So, you have no idea. I thought everybody would cheer. All right. If you want to come, you can meet out in the parking lot, but I'm not sure the doors are going to be open. But September 1st, so in 2 weeks, Russ is going to be bringing a message. You'll see myself and a few other pastors from the local churches kind of doing like our normal order service. It'll be online for you guys to watch whatever you want and enjoy it. And that way, all our staff members for our churches, our pastors, and others who are busy on Sundays get that Sunday off. And it's something that we're starting this year, and if it goes well, Russ would like to make it kind of like an annual thing where at least, again, you guys are awesome, and I get a lot of time when I need it, but there are some churches, even when they even get smaller than us, who maybe has just one person doing a lot of things on a Sunday, and that person's been doing a lot of things every Sunday for many years. It's so an opportunity for them to get a break, okay? I know you guys didn't sound excited. I'm sleeping in September 1st. So excited about that. I'm excited to hear from you guys now. That's all for our announcements. If you're just here for the first time or tuning in for the first time, this part of our service is our Be the Church time, a seeing God at work time. It's something that I really, really enjoy, and I often hear from you all that you enjoy it as well, because I shut up for a little bit, which is surprising to many, but we get to hear from you all. If you've seen God at work this week showing up, and you want to share that and celebrate that with your family, we want to hear from you so we can celebrate together. If you're here and you need to see God show up, you have a prayer need or a prayer request that you want to share, don't feel forced, but if you want to share with us so we can be in prayer, this is the time. I'll ask you to slip up your hand. Dee Boniface has got her hand first, and Cole will bring the microphone around. And if you'd wait for the microphone, and if you'd hold it up to your mouth, those things are going to really help us in our live stream to hear what you have to say. Dee Boniface, start us off.
Well, is this all right?
This is great. You're fantastic, Dee.
Well, getting me here, it was a miracle this morning. my daughter was determined.
Shelly was.
To get me here.
Good on her.
I told her I wanted to sleep in. No, you're going to church. Okay. So anyway, I sat there like this. She dressed me and got me here.
You look beautiful.
Thank
she did
you.
A good job dressing you.
She
did. I'm glad she did. It would be pretty awkward if you missed that part before coming to church.
But I want to thank everybody that sent me cards and came and visited me. I was at the Greystone, what do you call them, nursing home or whatever.
Yeah.
And they are wonderful. Yeah. They are just so sweet to me. Yeah. And I have been so blessed with my caregivers.
Absolutely.
And I want to thank them.
Yeah.
So
Thank you, Dee. It is so nice to have you back. And
it's nice being here.
I think everybody's always happy to see you. Shelly texted me last night, is the elevator working? I'm like, yeah, we got it. I said, yep, it's working. Shelly was able to bring her today, and yeah, I got to visit Dee at Greystone. I happened to show up when Teresa was there, and then I know she said some of you others have come. So glad that you're here, Shelly. Glad you're here and that you brought your mom, kicking and screaming, it sounds like, but that you're here. Couldn't keep her awake.
Yeah.
You know what? If you nod off during the message, totally fine. You take a rake. All right. Glad you're here, Dee. Hey, Nancy.
Good morning. I have two prayer requests. Earl is having a dental procedure on Wednesday. He's a little bit antsy about that.
Sure.
So if you'll pray for him that day. Also, my brother is still in intensive care. He had another episode, another setback this last week.
Ah.
We're hoping now that he's on a steady progress. They're hoping this week they can get him moved to progressive. So please keep praying for Bill.
Bill? Yeah, let's continue to pray for Nancy's brother, Bill. Absolutely, and definitely Earl. And you said that was Wednesday? Wednesday, his procedure? Absolutely. Yeah. Cole, looks like maybe Alicia's going to interrupt you, and then you're going to need to head over to this side.
Just in case anybody didn't see my Facebook post or the prayer chain post, please keep the Dexter family in your prayers. Pastor Bob was our pastor in the late 80s, early 90s when I was a little kid, and his wife Cheryl passed this last week. If I did post the address, but if you need the address to send Pastor Bob a little card or a note, just find me and I can help you with that.
Absolutely. Many of you were here when Bob Dexter was here. I know I've heard from many of you what a great time that was when he was your pastor. So lift him and his family up in his prayer as his wife had just passed. Absolutely. Mokta, how are you?
Good, thank you.
Good, looking 39 like always. That's a joke from last week. Never, it's all right.
I request to pray for my grandson, David.
Okay.
David Madden. They have an accident on Friday,
okay,
on 69. So everybody okay.
Okay.
But.
Just pray for David, though.
Yes.
Glad they're okay, but yeah, we'll pray.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Did I see you had your hand raised, Mary? Mary had her hand raised, Cole.
I'm excited to have my sister Sharon here from Arizona.
Ooh, Sharon.
So I have both my sisters here, my brother here, and we have lots of cousins and nephews and nieces coming in, and it's just going to be a great reunion weekend.
And is that today that they're all coming in?
Yes.
Is it today? I know you submitted that.
Some of them came yesterday, but yes,
today's
the day.
Whole family showing up.
Whole family.
I love God's stories. Go ahead, Sharon.
Okay, well, next door to where I live in Arizona is a house that is for women in recovery, court appointed, you know. And I was I found in my sewing things a dress that our mother had started many years ago. And I was finishing it up and I was trying to think who could wear this dress. Not me, I'm a little wider than I used to be. So.
Aren't we all, Sharon?
I went next door and asked the young lady to come over and try it on. So, okay, she did, and it fits. I said, okay, I'll finish it, and you may have it. So, we were looking at some of my books. The church I go to is also the Methodist Church, is half a block away. And I had some Bible study books there that I was sorting through. She looked at one and she said, oh, that's the one that our church was going to start this particular evening. It was a Thursday, I believe. I said, oh, that means you have to buy the book. She said, yeah. I said, take my book. She was so excited.
That's awful.
So the next morning, I finished the dress and went over to take it to her, and she came out and she said, I have to tell you the God story. Okay. She works at Home Depot in the return department, you know, at the desk. She said she was telling every customer that she was undecided as to whether to go to that book study or not. It was about women of faith or something of
sure.
that nature.
Yeah.
I forgot the exact title of the book, but anyway, she said, I wasn't sure I could get a book or afford a book. And this lady gives her a book. It's a God thing. And she went to the book study, and she was so happy about it. And she
Amen.
Was just saying, it's a God thing, otherwise I wouldn't have the book. She
Amen.
Was so excited.
Amen. Thanks for sharing that, Sharon. That's a great story. That's why we love doing this. I know there's a lot of churches maybe you've gone to don't often get a chance to do this, but it's always nice to hear from everybody and see God at work, and it should encourage and increase our faith as we continue to try to continually see God at work. So thanks for sharing that. Thanks for being here today, Sharon. Thank you so much. Anybody else? All right. Well, hey, after we always hear from people, we always like to have a few minutes of fellowship to get out of our pews and greet one another, and maybe you heard a story like Sharon's. You want to celebrate together or a prayer need, you can let somebody know you're praying. So let's get up out of our chairs, not you, D, you stay put, and let's fellowship together.
I actually remembered to turn on my mic. Last time I sang for the entire worship set, my mic was off.
As she's singing, I come over and I go.
Well, yeah, and then you just sort of left it on.
Love sees.
Join in Earl today in the offering. Sean? Oh, right. For those who don't know, when you volunteer to be an usher, you get to keep anything off the top. So let's go ahead and sign up for that. Awesome. No, that's not true. I'm being told never mind. We didn't pass. That did not pass ad councils. Never mind. I lied. All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Just want to pray now over our tithes and our offerings as we continue to worship. If you're here today and you don't call Trinity home and you don't feel so led, please let the plate pass you by. We just are so glad you're here and we want to minister to you. If you are here and you do feel like God's calling you to give, just a wonderful time to give. And thank you so much for your faithfulness. Again, we've talked a lot. You come in here and a 100-year-old building is starting to show its age. Talking a little bit about that in ad council. We'll have a meeting coming up with Russ and some of the others. But your faithfulness in giving, and God's been faithful to us. And just so grateful for that. Thank you for your continued giving. So just want to pray over these tithes and these offerings now, and then ask God to bless the rest of our service. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today so grateful for another week of the way you've watched over us. You've protected us and provided for us. Thank you so much for bringing everyone that's here today back here safe and sound through another week of your many, many blessings. Thank you for the way that you bless us with many, many things. And just one of those is just in resource, God, and the way you take care of us and our church, your church, through finances. So we just ask now that you bless these tithes and these offerings, God, that you're able to give those who handle the monies of this church guidance and discernment, God, as we are always looking to make decisions to show ourselves accountable, to be faithful stewards of these, your resource. So we ask not only that you bless these tithes and offerings, but you bless this time together as we continue to worship through song and then through the word and a message. God, we just ask that everything we do would be a sweet sound to your ear. Holy Spirit, we ask you now, we welcome you in to have your will and your way in this place. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Once the plate passes you by, if you're able and willing, please stand as we continue to sing with our band.
Day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with joy. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart. filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Thank you for meeting us here. I pray that you would speak through David, and I pray that you would open up our ears and our hearts to hear what you would have him say to us this morning. We ask this in your name. We love you. Amen.
Good morning. Today's word of the Lord reading comes from Luke chapter 6, verses 37 through 42. Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn others, or it will all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Give, and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back. Then Jesus gave the following illustration. Can one blind person lead another? Won't they both fall into a ditch? Students are not greater than their teacher, but the student who is fully trained will become like the teacher. And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying friend Let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye when you can't see past the log in your own eye. Hypocrite. First, get rid of the log in your own eye. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye.
Thank you, Cole. Again, a special thank you to Jordan and David. Again, hopefully you can stay and celebrate with us. Jordan came in today a little bit under the weather, so she's a big hugger and lover, but she's trying to stay distant from you guys. But kind of like with Kalila, we get lucky. We pay one salary but get two people. And Jordan and David are very similar in that way, that David's an incredible musician, and you just heard him sing. He's almost as good as I am, and that's saying something. Amen? And so for him to be, and we get David kind of free of charge some Sundays, so just so appreciate their willingness to step in and lead us in worship in the months ahead. And thank you guys. It was beautiful. I hope you guys were blessed. That was absolutely incredible. Want to continue to just kind of jump right in to what I've been kind of labeling a prequel series to where we're going to be headed in weeks ahead. If you've been tuning in, or if you haven't, we're in a series where we're looking at the idea of judgment and judging. We've spent a lot of time over the years, our Methodist church going through some major changes, where often as believers we wonder, you know, what does love require of us? So often we think that, well, yeah, well, we're afraid to love people unconditionally because, ooh, what if we come across as accepting of sinful behavior, or what if we're not standing on truth and these sorts of things? And so oftentimes we're trying to figure out, okay, we want to love people well, but what does that often require of us? And again, we're thinking in terms of judging others, or condemning others, or speaking truth to others, and what that looks like. And so we've been here for a few weeks. We're going to be here for a few more because, again, just kind of to let you behind the curtain, here in a few weeks when we're done with this series, we're jumping right into a series on politics. Exciting, right? Like, hey, here's two things never to talk about in public: faith and politics. So let's talk about faith and politics, right? That's kind of our thing here. But I think as we get close to November and we're already seeing a lot of what's going on in our world, in our nation especially, we know that being political is important for a Christian, but there's definitely ways that we can do it well. And we're not always represented by those who do it well. And often our friends and family are looking to us and saying, well, you represent Christ. How do you act inside the political arena? But before we do that, we thought we probably should hit this first. Because if we don't have a foundation based on love and trust and some things we're going to see, then our voice is kind of drowned out in the political arena. Then we just join the masses who are just yelling at each other back and forth over the aisle. And I don't think that's ever what God calls us to do. And so we've been in this series looking at love requires for us. Like, when do we speak up? You know, if we ever decide to speak up and say something or do something, you know, what does that look like? Or what do we say? Or how do we respond to maybe both believers and non-believers with truth in love? And so we started 2 weeks ago with this idea that Jesus didn't judge. That was the first part of the series. And we looked at the woman caught in adultery, where Jesus says, you know, where are your accusers? Because he says anybody without sin can cast the first stone, knowing that he was the only one that could have been just picking up a bunch of stones. And yet he didn't. And he tells her, I don't condemn you either. I don't judge you either. Go and sin no more. And so we knew, it sounds incredible, because there's been one person on this planet in the history of mankind who could have been a moral compass. Yet Jesus didn't want to be a moral compass. I mean, he showed us how to live, but that was never his main intention. You never see anywhere in scriptures where it said, and Jesus came to be the moral authority in the world. And even though he had those credentials, he didn't often use it that way. He was more concerned with other things, loving people where they're at, realizing, as Paul tells us in Romans, that it's his kindness that leads us to repentance. And so we know that Jesus didn't judge. And we also saw last week that love doesn't judge. We looked at 1 Corinthians 13, this great chapter on love from Paul, and we see that love covers a multitude of sins. It's hard to both judge and cover a multitude of sins at the same time. But love doesn't judge. And yet, as I kind of jokingly said last week, and there's a little bit of truth in every joke they say, that there's a little bit of Jesus in us. But if we're honest, sometimes that Pharisee can raise his ugly head, and we kind of are like, and I've kind of mentioned the last few weeks in jest, saying like, hey, I know some of you are waiting like for this sermon today. Like, you keep telling me I can't judge, and love doesn't judge. When am I allowed to say something? You know, and kind of joking, because that's what happens, right? That Pharisee rears its ugly head, and we're just like, well, I feel like I need to say something or do something, right? And there's a lot of truth in that. You know, my kids are now older, but when they were younger, if my son or my daughter went to put their hand on the stove and I just stood back and says, love stays quiet, right? Absolutely not. Because there's times when the situation causes love to intervene, and we should know that, because in the 5 years I've been here, we've preached many sermons on the fact that love is not passive, but it's always active, right? So there are times we're called to act. There are times we're called to say something. But as a whole, on the whole, that's not judgment, and we're going to see what that is today. Love doesn't judge. So I've titled today's message, Friends and Family Only. Today's message, and it's on the back of your outline, is Friends and Family Only. And as often happens when I'm preaching a series, I get to a point where I have this message and I'm looking at all my notes. I'm like, oh, this is long. And I try to break it up into two parts. And so it's kind of like that series I often say inside a series. So what we're going to see today is that there's really two pathways. There's two distinct groups of people, and I'm going to explain why I really don't even like that, but in this case it's accurate, and who they are to us and how we interact with them dictates what love requires of us. Friends and family only. And I'm going to hit you right from the beginning with one of the keys for today, and that is this. One of the main keys for today is that truth, real truth, requires relationship. Can you imagine if you just went around all the time judging people who you never met on the side of the road or the street? I mean, no, we would, you know, often we wouldn't think of that. Now, when you're a really good driver, you know me, and my love of all things road rage, that's still probably not the best thing to do. Because truth spoken, real truth spoken, requires relationship. And not only a relationship, but it requires a relationship wherein both parties know the foundation of their relationship is unconditional love. See, we could have some relationships with coworkers, but we would not say they're based on unconditional love. We might have some relationships with neighbors or maybe people we don't necessarily like but are in our circle, and we wouldn't say that that's founded on a basis, a foundation of unconditional love. So not only does truth require relationships, but it requires a relationship. They're the foundation. The very foundation is unconditional love. Look at this. I think this is fascinating. I tend to agree with this statement. That's why even Jesus didn't condemn. One of the reasons. There were many. But one of the reasons. He knew that speaking truth, the hard truth, that some people do need to hear, can only come in relationship marked first and foremost by love. Isn't that interesting? But when you think about it, we see Jesus spending a majority of his time, if he ever had maybe what we would consider a harsh word to speak, it was usually towards his disciples or the religious elite. Right? I mean, if we look at scriptures, Matthew, especially the four Gospels, we often see that Jesus reserved maybe what we would consider his harshest words for those in his inner circle, i.e. those who he had a relationship with, who he did daily life with, in the religious elite. But he knew that to just speak to them without a relationship is not the way to change hearts. It has to be a relationship marked with love. Can you imagine if somebody just did that? I mean, think about it. I know like a stranger can come up to you and maybe say something you don't know, and it can affect you. But I often feel like in science and psychology shows us that, you know, those same words spoken by someone we know carry a different amount of weight, right? I mean, oftentimes that carries a different amount of weight. Not that we don't like to get a compliment from somebody. Oh, lovely hair, David. Well, thank you. And it means, what's that? Amen. Thank you, Jerry. Amen, right? It is a good hair. No, it means something. But if my wife or my family or something says something and there's a relationship there, we not only hear the words, but we take in the history and the relationship inside those words, where we can't do that with a complete stranger. They're just words. Now, again, we should speak the truth in love, and there's nothing wrong with being kind. We're called to be so. But we know it hits different when it's done inside relationship. And the truth is the same, and truthfully speaking, it's the same on the other side. If it's not necessarily a compliment, but maybe a critique. You know, maybe that critique of, again, using a driving example, if someone's like, you know, you were terrible at driving, I don't know. You know, all those wholesome words we say to each other behind the wheel. Like, that means, you know, you're like, oh, man, that kind of stinks. That guy doesn't think I'm a good driver. But if someone you ride with all the time is, like, white-knuckling everywhere you go, right, and leaving finger marks in the, what we call the oh-no handle, like, that carries different weight because there's relationship there. It means something. We'll often listen to it because it's relational. It's covenantal language. So here's the key that we're going to unlock today, and this is where this sermon splits into two. There are two different scenarios we're going to see on how Jesus shows us to act in love or to speak in love, even sometimes to confront in love. There's two different scenarios, and though they both have a foundation of love in common, how we go about treating those people, talking to those people, confronting those people is completely two separate issues. First, we have how we confront, how we speak, how we interact with those inside our local congregation. That's one of the paths that we see split here, is there's a way that we're told to handle the relationships, how to speak to people, how to live with people, how to interact, and even at times confront people inside our local body of believers. And then the second path we're going to look at next week is how to do those exact same things, or if we're even allowed to do those exact same things outside the church, the rest of the world, if you will. So there's a divergent path here. And in fact, we see this very particular in Scripture. Before we move forward to this Scripture, we must understand the difference then of what love requires for us, both inside these walls and then outside these walls. And this is where I mean earlier, I hate that division. Ever since I've been here for 5 years, I have tried to tear down, and not that it was here, but in just society, I've tried to tear down that us versus them. Because that's the problem, is the tribalism today in our world, the polarization of our world. It's a we. We are in this together. Yet when it comes to how we are to treat others, the Bible even makes a clear distinction. So this is not me preaching like, hey, get in the club and enjoy all the benefits, and the heck with the rest of you. That's not what we're saying. Because it is a we thing. It's not an us versus them. But the Bible is clear that depending on how we have a relationship with those people, either inside the church through that relational, through a relationship built on a community of faith, versus those that we don't. And lucky for us, we have an absolutely perfect example for this in Scripture. Perfect. That covers both. So if you want in your Bibles, if you have them, it's going to actually be on the screen for you as well. And I'm reading now the NIV, so even the pew Bible in front of you is NIV. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians 5. Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth. 1 Corinthians 5. And 1 Corinthians 5 is only 13 verses, and we're going to read them all. Because it shows a perfect example through Paul's words, but also Jesus' examples of why it is and how it is that we're supposed to treat these two distinct relationships we have those again with those inside our churches, our local bodies, and those outside. 1 Corinthians 5, again, 1 through 13. It's going to be on your screen. I think I made a bunch of slides so I could not have to make it so tight. Hopefully you can read it. If not, again, you can feel free to follow along with your Bible or an electronic device. So let's lay the groundwork real quick. Some of you might know the story, but Paul is writing this letter to the church in Corinth. And in this particular part of the letter, he's upset with them because what is happening is there is a man in their congregation who is having an affair, a sexual relationship with what most scholars believe was like a stepmom of some sort, at least a wife of his father. So there was a family relationship there. Some would go as far as to say incest. And there's this relationship here, and what's going on is the church in Corinth is praising themselves. They're patting themselves on the back, saying, look how gracious we are. You can come to church while you still sleep with your mother-in-law. And they're using it as a source of pride. And Paul, I see, lovingly, even though he uses harsh language, calls them out. So let's pick it up and just read it. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 1, it is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that even pagans, and in this sense, pagans was anybody in the Gentile world outside of the Jewish believing or the Christian believing church at the time. So again, here, right here, we see a separation between inside the church and outside. Even pagans do not tolerate. A man is sleeping with his father's wife, and you are proud. Shouldn't you rather have gone into mourning and have put out of your fellowship? Again, I kind of highlighted or underlined every term you're going to read here that kind of shows that distinction between in and out. Have put out of your fellowship the man who has been doing this? For my part, even though I am not physically present, I am with you in spirit. As one who is present with you in the way, I have already passed judgment. Ooh, there we see that judgment. In the name of our Lord Jesus, on the one who has been doing this. So when you are assembled and I am with you in spirit, in the power of our Lord Jesus is present, hand this man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. And we're not going to spend a lot of time there, but right there, if we read, what Paul's saying is, we're giving him, the Message translation, basically, if you will, which is kind of like, here's just plain English. Kick him out of the church, but only do so that his heart can be softened to the truth, he can be forgiven, and you can welcome him back. Don't kick him out to judge him and accuse him, but kick him out so that Satan can be defeated, he can come to repentance, hopefully through this like temporary excommunication, and then welcome him back in open arms. And we see in the second letter to Corinthians that Paul even says and apologizes for being so harsh and is happy they've brought him back. But he even says, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. Your boasting is not good. Don't you know that a little yeast leavens the whole batch of dough? Get rid of the old yeast. Old yeast, yeast in the Bible representing sin. Get rid of the old yeast so that you may be a new unleavened batch as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us keep the festival, not with the old bread leavened with malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Moving on, verse 9. I wrote to you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people. Now listen to, here we go. We see in verse 10, this is an important verse. Not at all meaning the people of this world who are immoral. So if Paul says refrain from people who are sexually immoral, but not of this world, again, if there's two sides and you're either of the world or you're in the local body of believers, we know Paul's now talking and saying don't associate with those people inside the body of Christ. You see that? Makes sense? Which, by the way, we should stop right there, and that should make us very cautious to ever judge anybody, because Paul's talking to a church that he understands there's going to be sexual immorality, and that's not the goal, but the church is a hospital for the sick, and if we wait for everybody to get clean before we come in here, we're doing it wrong. Amen? Boy, have you ever tried to clean a fish before you catch it? Boy, that'd be freaking tough. Like, I don't know how you would do it. Maybe, I'm not a fisherman, but maybe you fishermen know of a way to do it, but it seems really weird, and yet that's what the church often does. And we hear people like, well, I'm going to get my act together, then come to church. You're never going to get your act together without coming to church, because this is where Jesus does the work that we cannot do. So it's not at all meaning the people of the world who are immoral or the greedy and swindlers or idolaters. In that case, you would have to leave this world. But now I am writing to you that you must not associate with anyone who claims to be a brother or sister. There we go. Who claims to be in the family of God, especially the local family of God, an individual congregation, just like us here at Trinity. With anyone who claims to be a brother or sister, but is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater or slanderer, I can't say that word, a drunkard or swindler, do not even eat with such people. What business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? Well, there you go. It's one of the main questions for this whole series. What business is it of mine to do that? And next week we're going to see why. What business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? Are you not to judge those inside? Boom, there's the distinction again. Plain as can be. It's not my business to judge those outside the walls, but are you not to judge those inside the walls? God will judge those outside. Expel the wicked person from among you. Pretty clear. In a few examples, that Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is saying, listen, the way we treat those in our local body is different than the way we treat those in the world. And it should be. It makes sense, because we're right back to what? Relationship. We have a relationship that should be different than some of the relationships outside the world. Hopefully, we are a family. Hopefully, we can be honest and vulnerable with each other. Hopefully, we can pray together. Hopefully, we can be vulnerable with one another. That's the privilege of being in a local body. And Paul is saying, hey, what business is it of mine to judge outside, but those inside the church? I've been reading a book recently by Greg Boyd. He's one of my favorite authors. He talks so much about our American history and politics and what it has to do with Christianity. And this is a paraphrase of his, and I really like this. And I put on the fiery stove as a reminder of our kids, right, touching the fiery stove. In contexts where people have entered into a covenantal relationship with us. That's a big, long first sentence. Us here, we are in a covenantal relationship together. We worship together. We decide to be in a local body together. We decide to do life together. We decide to grow more like Jesus together. And we're bonded by covenant as we're members of Trinity. And that's why it's even more specific to Trinity, because I don't have the same relationship with people all over the world in churches. They're my brothers and sisters in Christ, yet I don't know most of them. But we are to know each other and be in covenantal relationship together. In context for people I've entered into a covenantal relationship with us, confronting damaging, dangerous behavior can be necessary and expected. In cases where people feel known and loved by others, this confrontation will hopefully be received in love rather than condemnation. All right, message translation. Y'all signed up for this. That's Eugene Peterson's version. Y'all signed up for this. You said, I'm going to covenant with other people. And many of you have been covenanting together for years. Years, decades together. And what that means is, and this is something that many churches get wrong, we always have to be careful, is often we skew one side or the other, and we'll skew about all the privileges of being in a house of God, and we'll forget all the responsibilities that go with it, or vice versa. We only talk about the responsibilities of belonging to a local body and not the privileges. Here is a privilege and a responsibility inside a covenant relationship. We should have, and I hope we do, and I believe we do, the type of relationships where we could confront dangerous behavior and it would be received in love rather than condemnation. I hope that's our church. Because that's the early church in Acts. That's the church that we want to emulate. We're going to see both today and next week. It's the church that Jesus desires. But you signed up for it. This is your local body. And as such, we're treated different. We treat each other different. I mean, think about it. Some of you would probably feel those who would feel like they could, and I hope many of you do, if not all, feel like you could call out your pastor. Like, hey, your hair wasn't good today. I don't know, something, right? Hopefully you feel like you could call out your pastor. I don't always have to agree, but I would dare say that probably many of you wouldn't feel like you could call out a pastor down the street. Well, why? We don't know that pastor. There's no relationship. We don't even know what's going on. But we have a relationship. You know me. I know you. And inside that relationship comes both privilege and responsibility. And both combined is that when we see dangerous or unhealthy or sinful behavior, we are to call it out. But again, we're not even supposed to do that if it's not a foundational relationship built on love. See, it doesn't give me carte blanche, and that's what we do sometimes. We use it as a weapon. That kind of joke, you signed up for that. Well, that doesn't mean because you signed up for it, I can come with the Bible over your head and just start pounding you. Hey, this is love. You're an idiot. But I mean it in love. That was a horrible decision, you moron. No, that doesn't give us carte blanche to do it, because we've seen from the very beginning that if its foundation is not love, then we shouldn't be saying it. And often we find ourselves doing that. I've mentioned that's one of the things I learned in COVID. During COVID, this is one of the things I learned. There was a time when life was starting to get back to normal during COVID, or our new normal, whatever you want to call it, where it was time to get back to church for many of us. It was time. And there were people that called Trinity home. There were friends of mine who called other churches home that were continually using COVID as an excuse to not go back, which some believed that. We're not going to get political on COVID. But what made me wonder about what they were really saying when they were missing church is I would always see them outside the grocery store, the restaurants, the school, the kids' games. They were able to go everywhere else, but they weren't ready to come back to church. Okay, we know that happened. That's not the point of the story. That's just the context for the story. And so I wanted to get online and say, it's flipping time to get back to church, folks. I really did. I wanted to say that. But I felt like the Holy Spirit really checked me on this. And you know me, I'm not one of those, ooh, the Holy Spirit's always talking. I wish he would talk more to me. I don't always hear him. But in this case, I heard him, and I felt like you could say that exact same thing. You could use those exact same words, and you could, there's a time where you could post it and be right with me, and there's a time you could post those exact same words and be wrong with me. And it came down to, what is my motivation? Was my motivation, I was sick and tired of just talking to the camera, and I wanted to call people out and be like, hey, let's go. It's time to get back in church. Or was I willing to say that, and I can honestly and genuinely say it was out of true, true love, that you need community, we need to get back where we can grow together and become more like Jesus. Well, if you go back to my Facebook, you'll see that I never posted that. Because in my heart, I could not ever get to the point where I really believed it was just genuine love and there wasn't a little bit of that. So it still has to be done in love, yet we see here it's a different scenario than those outside the church. I absolutely love this. This is the second key for today. Oh, so good. Condemnation might yield short-term conformity, but it will not yield long-term change of heart. That is so good. Earl, what'd you charge for people to come in today? How much did you charge for people to come in today? You just took it out of the offering plate because that's worth the price of admission right there. Condemnation might yield short, and that's what happens, right? That's what happens when churches or religion is preached on fear or condemnation. It might change our behavior for a little bit, but if we're not doing it for the right reason, that's a short-term change. Anybody ever been around people who are all of a sudden on fire for God or doing these things, and it's only a couple months, you're like, I ain't seen them in a minute. I have. Have you ever been that person? I have. Right? I feel bad. You go to a conference where the pastor says something, and some of you have even said it. You're like, Pastor, you've been reading my mail? Oh, man. And that's never the goal, right? But we feel condemned or convicted, and it requires short-term change, but it never yields that long-term lasting change, and that shouldn't surprise us, because only God can do that. And it's not about behavior modification. I say that time and time again. It's not about behavior modification. We saw that last week. Isn't it so incredible that God's love is so powerful because it's given before the change? Condemnation will only go so far. This is another quote from Boyd, so I copied it kind of verbatim, except in the parentheses I had to make it current. For Jesus and Paul, their only concern was that kingdom people consistently live out the new life they have within the kingdom. I'm going to stop there. That's it. You've heard me say, I actually was in a pastoral meeting this week, and I said the same thing. Like, what's been on your soul? What have you been wrestling with? And you guys have heard me say it for the last few years. Here's what I wrestle with. I am sick and tired of my life not being the abundant life I'm promised in Scripture. I'm sick and tired of my daily life not looking like what life looked in Scripture. I'm tired of living below the promises of God. Amen? I'm tired of it. You should be too. Right? Because that's why Jesus came, that we would have new life within the kingdom. For only when we do this will they offer the culture at large, will we offer the culture at large a beautiful kingdom alternative to their present sinful, self-centered, and ultimately destructive way of life. That's why so many times I preach to you guys, like I'll ask around, like, you guys happy to be here? Like, tell your faces. Right? Because so many times in our lives, we wonder why everybody doesn't want to be like us. But we all act like that teacher in Ferris Bueller's Day Off. Right? Mom, Bueller. Man, it is awesome to be a Christian. I am so full of joy and love and peace. Come to church. I love my church. It's awesome. Really? Come on. What the culture around us wants to see is a beautiful kingdom alternative. Our lives aren't perfect. I sin. I mess up. There's things I want God to do in my life that He's yet to do. It's not waiting for being perfect, but it's saying it's a beautiful life. It's a beautiful life together in community. That's why Jesus came. That's why, I'm going to ask the team as they start to come forward as we close. We're just another slide or two away. We've been looking the last couple weeks, you know, oh, we don't judge. But yeah, we do have times where we're supposed to tell the kid to put their hand off the hot stove, right? There's times we see destructive behavior. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, there's some scenarios we would never think twice about saying something, right? Like, I would hope if all of a sudden, like, those candles go up in flames and catch everything there, I hope you guys aren't, well, like, we're going to wait for God to let David know. Or listen, I'm nobody's boss. I can't tell him to flee this scene. Love wouldn't do that. Yeah, those kind of things. Like, we laugh because, like, that's foolish. So in this covenantal relationship we have, there's times we're going to see behavior that we have to confront. But I would dare say this. If you're more excited to confront that person than in true empathy love that person, put on the brakes. Put on the brakes. Ooh, I cannot wait for Jerry Fisher to mess up. Amen. I heard it, Mokta. I can't wait. Oh, I've been waiting for him to just, really? Really? Absolutely not. Now, the privilege and responsibility we have, we're in covenantal relationship. I hope to speak truth to Jerry. Jerry speaks truth to me. But if that's my mentality, if that's my motivation, then again, I'm doing it wrong. Can you see that even though it's a different relationship than the outside world, even though it's inside the walls, it still has to be love? That doesn't give us the absolute right just to say whatever. Luckily, Jerry's an upstanding citizen. But if I ever had to confront him with something, I hope that it would be out of a lifestyle committed on my knees with tears in my eyes, begging God to use somebody else but me because I love this man or I love everybody here so much that I don't want to do that, right? That should be our motivation. Oh, God, I don't want to do that because I love him. I don't want to hurt him. I'm afraid. Like, that should be the and if then that's the motivation, I wonder if that's not the heart God's waiting for to say, no, that's exactly why I picked you. I I have one more slide, but then there's this story that kind of goes along with us. There's this, I think I've told it before in this church, there was this pastor who had just come to this a country church as a brand new appointment. And there was these, two friends, and one belonged to the church, and one was an outsider. And they were talking one day over coffee, and the outsider friend said, "Hey, how's that new pastor working?" And the guy's like, "Oh, he's pretty good." And the friend's like, "Well, like, what does he talk about? Like, pastors, they all just talk about the same." And the guy who goes to the church said, "Well, this pastor comes in and says that we're all sinners, that we've all screwed up, that we all need forgiveness, and that we all need grace." And the friend goes, "Well, but then what did the old pastor preach?" And the old pastor preached that we were all sinners, that we've all screwed up, and that we all need grace. And the friend looked at him and says, "I can't see the difference between the two." And the gentleman said, "Yeah, but this pastor says it with tears in his eyes." That's how we confront people in the church. We don't use it as carte blanche. It's with tears in our eyes, knowing only by the grace of God go we. Only like what we read earlier in John about the speck in our eye. Only the only time I should confront anybody is when I just, by grace, realize that it's like I have a huge log here. And God somehow trusts me enough in covenant relationship to help my brother with his speck. There's a reason he used log and speck. Because so many times we get it reversed. We think our sins are just specks, but everybody else is logs. Right? But not according to Scripture. We're walking around with a forest in our eyes. He goes, God, and Jesus says, get rid of that first. Get rid of that first. Before you help your brother or sister. If you call Trinity home or wherever you might go to church, you're in a covenantal relationship that can require at times confronting. That's why it is different. We're going to see next week how this looks different for those who are outside our walls. But that does not give us, again, carte blanche. It does not give us free invitation to do so. I would love to be a church known as people who just absolutely loathe confronting someone. Because we're overwhelmed by God's grace to us and we want to give that to everybody else. Yet we do so when the time is right. But only in love. So this is our last slide. Gray. It's just gray, isn't it? See, it's so hard because for so long, Christian and science and 2,000 years of battle back and forth, and many of us Christians and especially some of our brothers and sisters in other denominations, so we just make it black and white. It's gray. It's gray. There's this gray area then where people are coming to church and yet they're not experiencing the full love of God yet, right? There's this grayness. That kind of in between. But that's going to wait for next week. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your grace. It's only by the grace of God go we. And God, we have so forgotten. We have so forgotten how low the bar is to be one of your children, right? It's just to call on your name. We don't have to have it all together. Archbishop Desmond Tutu says this. He says, God, you have incredibly low standards. And we're so grateful for those low standards in our own lives, and yet as soon as we kind of feel like we're in, we want to start raising the bar. We forget it's all grace. It's all love. It's nothing we can do. Nothing we can do to make you love us more. Nothing you can do to make you love us less. And God, thank you for the privileges and the responsibilities of belonging to this local body of believers, where we have chosen, as I jokingly said, we signed up for this. We signed up for the privileges, but we also get thrown in the responsibilities. Help us to be a people who confront only when necessary and only when love is the foundation. And God, one of the biggest things I know I need is help us when we become the confronted one to receive the truth and love, to not feel attacked, God, so many times my prayer over the last few years as I've been a pastor and things are said of me or said about me that I might not like is, God, let me eat the meat, spit out the bones. God, let me see, even though I might not like what that person said, even though that might hurt my feelings, God, let me see the truth through that you might be speaking to me. So if we ever become the ones on the other side being confronted, gently restore us. Help us receive and remove the log out of our eye. And then only then, in love, help our brother or sister with the speck in theirs. In Christ's name, amen. Never want to leave this time together without a time of prayer, altar call, if you will. Just a time for us to take a few minutes maybe to just kind of absorb what we've said. I often feel like I give a lot of information, kind of like my sermons feel like maybe you're drinking out of a fire hydrant, right? It's just a lot coming at us. So just in an attitude of reverence, our band's going to play in just a minute this song, a beautiful song. But if you're here today and you need prayer for anything, whatever that might be, something to do with today's message, something entirely different, just a beautiful opportunity lays before us to do so. God will meet you where you're at in your pew. If you feel a little embarrassed and don't want to walk down these steps, you don't have to. God's there. Maybe you're sitting next to someone, you want them to pray. These altars are open if you feel like you just want to come down, kneel down, and pray. I'm here with you. I'll turn the microphone off, and where two or three are gathered, we know God is with us, and we can pray together. If that's not you, we just ask that you be in reverence. Maybe ask God the bottom of your, I don't mention this every Sunday, but we always have those questions at the bottom of our bulletin under the notes, because that's always the goal. My prayer is that you guys are always answering those questions after each and every Sunday. What is God saying to you, and what are you going to do about it? Before service, we had a time of prayer, and during that time, we pray over you guys, we pray over the service, and then we spend a few minutes just listening for the Holy Spirit, believing that He still speaks today. Amen? We're a believing church in that. And so we say, all right, then speak. And as we were sitting in the silence today, someone felt like they might have gotten a word from the Lord. So I want to share it with you because maybe it's for you. We are honest. We get it wrong sometimes. What do I jokingly say? Maybe we just had a bad burrito last night. I'm not trying to be funny, but we don't know if it's God or not. But we're willing to be made fools for Christ because maybe there's someone here who needs this word. Amen? And the word that person got was, there's someone here who could just be extremely tired or exhausted. And God just wants to give you rest. Maybe that's for you today. When it was said, it sure felt like me. I was pretty tired this morning. Otherwise, if you're willing and able, please stand with us as we sing our closing song.
Could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do.
So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that
got one response. I've got just one move.
with my arms stretched wide, I will worship you.
So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. All that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. You've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Sing that one more time.
Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Tune into the radio, Brandon Lake's an incredible, what a beautiful song of gratitude. And sometimes maybe that's all you feel like you have right now. Maybe that's why it's hard to be grateful, because you're like, I don't know what I have to be grateful for, but just the gratitude. What a beautiful song. We just thank you so much, our worship team. I asked them as soon as we dismiss here, just a second, to continue playing. Hope you can stay to hang out with our new friends, Jordan and David, who are going to be with us. Hope you were blessed by them today. Incredible, I think an incredible time of worship. You can clap for him. It's all right. Just appreciate their spirits and their willingness to be with us in the months ahead. Obviously, continuing to pray for Will and Kalila. I know they're down in their place now and are safe, and I know God's using them in a mighty way. But hope you could stay and enjoy a little bit of cake with us as we're dismissing. Again, if you're interested in knowing more about the Guatemala trip we're looking to take in March, maybe just these first couple rows and Lanessa will join. Otherwise, I'll be in the back. To shake your hands. But let me bless us now as we go out. So now, may love without limits be the foundation of our relationships with everyone. May all we do and all we say be seasoned with unrestricted grace. And may we continually give unconditional love even before we give loving truth. Grace and peace. We are dismissed.
So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah.
I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah,
I don't know if I'm looking at anyone.